Hey everybody, it's Sheila again.
It's Dr. Diane Ginsberg, and welcome to Optimal Health Redefined.
So we want to talk today about inflammation. I have mentioned to Dr. Ginsberg this morning, we are seeing a run of people that their C-reactive protein levels in labs, and we get that in just about everyone, especially if they complain of weight gain. We get a certain panel on them, and I would say, I've been doing this for like 12 to 15 years now. Oh my gosh. And I used to see CRPs, hovering around 3. Anything over 3 in lab work on a C-reactive protein level is considered high. And we would see some around 3, but, not too many. I would say in the last year, and really in the last 6 months, I have seen levels through the roof that I have not seen in years. I mean,
yes,
you would have more experience than me in that, but
yes.
We're seeing levels over 10. I had someone come in the other day with a level of 60. It's just very worrying. But I don't know that, people understand what that means. And especially in regards to weight gain and inability to lose weight, inflammation is that word that you hear all the time. And C-reactive protein is a marker of inflammation put out by the liver. Why don't you tell a little bit more medically about what that means?
And the double whammy with that, unfortunately, is your C-reactive protein isn't often checked by your doc, and he'll check your glucose and your insulin, and he'll go there in the normal range. Remember, anything abnormal with LabCorp, it's like you're way off.
You're very sick already.
Right. So they're high normal levels. You're still already in trouble. So those numbers will be normal. The way I look at C-reactive protein, and hopefully this will ground inflammation, the term for you a little bit, is inflammation is significant, right? It is the little particles our body releases to clean up stuff that shouldn't be there. Dead bug particles, pieces of food you can't digest, the shampoo particles that got in through your skin that your body can't do anything with. You need to recycle it or you need to dump it. Well, what happens is whether there's too much of a toxic load from the outside or your food that you're eating has too many fake particles in it, too many foreign things, too many processed things that the body doesn't recognize. What will happen is you will get dysregulation in the gut. You will get increased weakening, if you would, of the gut lining. And that's the leaky gut term that you hear about. Now, about 2% of your food leaks out anyway. There's an acceptable amount. What starts to happen is when it gets worse, you get a larger amount that leaks out. And when you start getting food particles and bug particles into your bloodstream, your body recognizes it as foreign. So it will attack it. That's the job of your immune system. So now the body is shifting from, I'm going to build muscle, I'm going to build bone, I'm going to work my metabolism to make me efficient, to I've got to deal with what's going on immediately. And it shuts everything else down. It shuts down the aggressive build, so your metabolism may go down a little bit. It shuts down everything positive that it's going to do. And the key is get into trouble, get back out, and grow again. Well, when you wind up with this chronic dysregulation where the system is overwhelmed by all the things I described, two big problems happen. Number one, the system won't burn well, so you're not going to drop your insulin and your sugar, and Sheila's going to get into that, why you're not going to lose weight. But what also is going to happen is your body's going to start worrying for its life. What if all these particles that have these immune complexes stuck to them that start to get big break the small blood vessels? Right? We all know that with diabetes, what happens? They have more problems with their eyes. They tend to get more infections and they can't heal in their feet because the blood vessels get smaller and smaller and smaller, kind of like a river gets smaller and smaller and smaller. If you run a tree across the Mississippi River, it's not a problem. If you run a tree across a little river, it could kill a whole town because you kill its water supply. So what happens here is the body freaks. It says, look at all these inflammatory markers. Look at all these antibodies clumped together. I've got to get rid of them. And the liver shoots out C-reactive protein, almost like a magnet to pick up all this extra garbage, drag it to the liver and clean it out. So that when people say, oh, I'm feeling inflamed, do something, understand it. It's not do something. It's the state that your body's in. There's nothing anybody can give you. It's what you're going to do to realize my life has created this tip and my body is trying to save it. So when your C-reactive protein is elevated, the last thing you're going to do is calm your insulin, calm your blood sugar, and work towards building muscle. So now when you eat and you raise your insulin and blood sugar, even if it's not pathological, outside LabCorp or Quest's numbers, It's going to float up here, but what's going to happen is it's never going to drop enough and the system's never going to calm enough to pull on fat. So you'll put a little more fat on from the meal that you've eaten. And now when you go to bed at night, what's going to happen is the system is going to just stay elevated, inflamed, and you're not going to pull on anything. Now you're going to wake up in the morning and eat, and maybe you'll eat a couple more calories than you need at that moment. So you'll pack a little bit on, but it's a one-way valve. It'll never come off. So looking at that number is very key to give you an idea of the state you're in.
Yeah, and I would say that we're seeing a pattern, and let me, these are the labs that we will generally get pretty much on a lot, I would say majority of our patients, especially when they complain of weight gain or just kind of chronic inflammation signs of fatigue and poor sleep and moods and things like that. And so we will get a C-reactive protein, hopefully a high sensitivity one. There is a difference. We will get a leptin because this is your hormone that upregulates when you gain body fat to tell the brain that it needs to make you less hungry and speed up metabolism. What we're seeing, the pattern is that this C-reactive protein is above 3, which is elevated. It really should be lower than 1. When we're seeing this elevation in CRP, we are seeing leptin levels through the roof. A normal, it's hard to say what normal leptin is because it depends on what your BMI is. But, you know, ideally we would see leptin, I would say, around the 20 range.
Even, or 18.
Maybe even lower than that.
Yeah.
We are seeing leptin in the 60s plus because this hormone is trying to tell the brain, speed up her metabolism, make her less hungry so we can get body fat down to normal. And because there's so much inflammation present, the brain cannot hear this. It is in fight or flight mode all the time. It's ignoring this signal and it's just telling insulin store, store, store. And so that's why we like to get all this together, because all of this will tell us a clear picture. We want your hemoglobin A1C to be around 5%. So we know that you haven't had a ton of sugar stuck to your blood over the last few months. Really anything over 5 is a little bit too high for our eyes in functional ideal medicine. But the labs will say anything below 5.6 is fine, but we don't want you running that high. And then insulin, there's a balance here. So we want it to be around 7, but we don't want it to be at a 2 or a 4. That's also a sign that something is wrong. And that usually when we get at that low level, something is really wrong. The body is really dysregulated and in too much fight or flight mode here. And then glucose, you can see normal levels run from about 70 to 85. This is fasting. We're seeing levels fasting, you know, around 99, which is considered normal, but is too high. You haven't eaten anything and you're starting off the day already at a 99. So we know when you eat a meal, it's going to shoot up past that. It's going to elevate your insulin and you're going to throw this all out of whack. So this is a really important panel. It is not super expensive, you know, and I feel like this can tell you a lot, because when I'm seeing these two together super elevated, we know we need to put you on an anti-inflammatory diet and lifestyle choices to get this down. Some of the things that you really need to think about if you've had these markers, especially this one, and you've seen it above 3, you need to be eating anti-inflammatory fats. So stay away from processed foods. Stay away from the seed industrial vegetable oils like canola and cottonseed and soybean oil and peanut oil. All of those are super high in fats that will elevate inflammation in the body. You need to really focus on omega-3 anti-inflammatory fats. Put a lot of fish into your diet. Get a lot of olive oil. So the Mediterranean diet was kind of created around an anti-inflammatory picture. And so the basis of that is good. We want a lot of veggies in there, those different compounds of antioxidants, and even spices like garlic and turmeric and ginger. All of that in there, green tea, can help lower the amount of inflammation in the body. Exercise, movement has been shown to really decrease inflammation. Get sleep. You know, sleep is a struggle for a lot of people, but if you can just dedicate of like, I'm going to try to go to bed around 10, I'm going to turn off my phone, I'm going to make it super dark in my house, I'm going to set up a ritual to support sleep. Whether or not you fall asleep is not up to you per se, but you can create that environment for you to have good sleep. And generally, the more exercise you get and the more sunshine you get during the day, the better your ability to fall and stay asleep will be. So all of this is going to go together. There are some supplements that I will use when we see high inflammation. I like to use proteolytic enzymes like protease from Transformation Enzymes. I like to use curcumin a lot, like Ortho Molecular makes a Terriva that I will use. Sometimes I'll put antioxidants in there. I'll add fish oil. But generally, we really work on diet and really try to hammer home, like, you need to change your parameters. Sugar, we know, is very inflammatory. Alcohol can be inflammatory. So those are the things we try to work around. We are actually putting together an online class right now called The Real Food Rebuild. The whole basis of it is to get your inflammation down. And it is just a real world diet that's based on the principles that I just talked about. It'll be available online, hopefully by September. It's kind of our goal. And it's just going to teach you about the different aspects of why inflammation is a problem and how changing your diet can help decrease that inflammation. But you can also come see us. We'll run these labs. And I feel like having someone look at it and, you know, help you interpret it is always really helpful. So I hope that you found this helpful. I feel like these are things that are overlooked that are a really big deal.
Absolutely.
All right. Thanks.